Action de grâce pour le roi, action de grâce pour le tout puissant, action de grâce sous Dieu de miséricorde. Maintenant, merci, alléluia. Merci, alléluia. Merci, alléluia. Merci, mon sauveur. Merci, alléluia. N'a vive, alléluia. Nous m'accompagne comment n'a vive, maintenant. Nous m'accompagne comment nous faire la place. Nous m'accompagne comment nous faire la maintenant, grand bon Dieu. Maintenant, merci, grand bon Dieu. Nous adorons, cher sauveur. Même Jean David t'a adoré au Seigneur. Même Jean David, pas trop adoré. Il pas trop adoré au l'éternel Dieu d'amour. Là, on est premier verset 7. Il dit alléluia. Je n'ai point honte de l'évangile. 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 Car c'est une puissance. Car c'est une puissance. Car c'est une puissance. Car c'est une puissance. Je n'ai point honte de l'évangile. Ma honte parler de mon Dieu. Ma honte parler de l'évangile. L'évangile fait me sentir bon aujourd'hui. L'évangile me parle aujourd'hui. L'évangile me parle de chaque qui l'a marqué. Qu'est-ce que l'on doit marquer? Qu'est-ce que l'on doit s'arrêter marquer? Qu'est-ce que l'on doit regarder? L'évangile prend nous loin. Il prend nous loin. Il prend nous loin marquer. Reconnaître que mon Dieu prend. Reconnaître que mon Dieu est sorti avant. Reconnaître que ta route est marquée. Reconnaître que ta route est qu'on parle. Qui chante qu'on parle ailleurs. Comment je dis ailleurs? Alléluia. Reconnaître-toi marquer, grand mon Dieu. Reconnaître-toi marquer. Reconnaître-toi marquer.
Sacre la prison, 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 sacre la prison Of God, I don't know about you. I feel the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. Let's put it back in the hand of Bishop. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Jesus.
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Just fall over me. Take the devil's kingdom down. We're going up.
morning, but I'm here to tell you a true army of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
When it's raining, they don't stay home.
That's right.
It doesn't base on what the water looks like. It's not based on what the situation is.
Right.
It's based on the purpose of God. Because God is the only one that brought you up.
Amen.
He's the only one that wake you up.
Amen.
When the things are going sour, you are still entitled to praise Him. You got to acknowledge the troubles. You got to begin to praise Him. When you think that you're not going to wake up, when you wake up in the morning, you got to say, I'm going to praise Him. When somebody thinks you're going to do so much, they think you're not going to make it. When you get up in the morning, you got to say, I'm going to praise Him. No matter what's going on, Bishop, you got to praise Him. My back is killing me, but I got to praise Him. I got a headache, I got to praise Him. Somebody talking about me, I got to praise Him. He didn't tell us to bring the problem inside. But I'm here to tell you the same way that you can, you would not live the same way. Hallelujah, somebody. Say, Pastor, I receive it. Say, Pastor, I receive it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's do scripture reading. Thank you, Jesus, for the marvelous worship. I thank God for the special visit of the Holy Ghost. I truly feel the presence of God, Bishop. I feel His presence up in this place. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord, church.
Yes, praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
I'll stand for the reading of the word.
Hallelujah.
We are in Luke chapter 17.
Thank you, Lord.
That's Luke chapter 17.
Hallelujah.
Luke chapter 17 reads, now when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God does not come with observation, mm-hmm. nor will they say, see here or yes. see there. For indeed, the kingdom of God is within you.
Come on.
Amen.
Then he said to the disciples,
uh-huh.
the days will come when you will desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and you will not see it. And they will say to you, look here, or look there. Do not go after them or follow them. For as the lightning that flashes out of one part under heaven shines to the other part under heaven,
uh-huh.
so also the Son of Man will be in his day.
Yes.
Amen.
But first, he must suffer many things and be rejected by his generation.
Uh-huh.
And as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be also in the days of the Son of Man.
Yes.
Yes.
They ate, they drank, they married wives. They were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all.
Mm-hmm.
Likewise, as it was also in the days of Lot, they ate, they drank,
yes.
they bought, they sold, they planted, they built. But on the day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and
yes.
destroyed them all.
Yes.
Even so will it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. In that day, he who is on the housetop and his goods are in the house. Let him not come down to take them away. And likewise, the one who is in the field, let him not turn back. Remember Lot's wife? Mm-hmm. Whoever seeks to save his life will lose it. And whoever loses his life will preserve it. I tell you, in that night there will be two men in one bed. The one will be taken and the other will be left. Two women will be grinding together. The one will be taken and the other left. Two men will be in the field. The one will be taken and the other left. And they answered and said to him, "Where, Lord?" So he said to them, "Wherever the body is, there the eagles will be gathered together."
Hallelujah.
That's
the reading of the word.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Once again, I want to thank you all for coming out today. It's a great day.
Yes, amen.
It is a great day.
Hallelujah.
I know you probably said, okay, it's not a great day because it's not sunny.
Oh,
but I mean to tell you that is the day that the Lord has made.
Amen.
Let us be glad. What?
Amen. Rejoice.
Rejoice. And be glad in it.
Yes.
Amen. I thank God for our sisters and brothers that make it today. God bless you.
Hallelujah.
Good to see you. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. And I just want to thank everybody, you know, Bishop, I'm there. Can you stand and say your name and...
Well, I'm Jason, everybody.
Amen.
Hello.
Nice to meet you. And I'm with Bishop Dowie.
Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you.
God bless you. Amen. I'm glad you're here. And we know everybody. We just want to thank God for all of you that's here. Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know, this weekend they have an event. Sister Nellie went there with Pastor Carter, and then she won a prize for singing the gospel.
Wow. Amen.
And her husband, and I want to give that to them that they sent for them. They sent them a t-shirt for winning the gospel at the, it was in Yam.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So they have a sweet yam.
Yeah. They have a yam.
Yeah. So they was there. They had a great time. And they have one shirt for her, one shirt for her husband. And also, yes, you know, I just want to thank God for the move, you know, of the Holy Ghost this morning. Amen. Because I truly believe that, you know, sometime, you know, we need to be refilled. Amen. Yes.
Amen.
When our oil is running down, you know, we have to refill.
Yes.
You know, so I think today is the day that we will feel.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I think especially I had this, my good friend, Bishop Dowie, a friend of Bishop as well. So, you know, I introduced, you know, I bring him down to preach for us today. Amen. And I know God will do great things to him.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And before, you know, I know I'm going to have my son, you know, let sister... How you feeling? You want to bless us with this song with Bishop? You know, so you don't want to, you don't feel okay? If you don't, oh, okay, oh. He wants the Anna. Yeah, let her bless us with this song with Bishop. She's been practicing, and let's do that. And
Amen.
Amen. And I want my brother to bless us with one too as well. Amen. So he probably a little bit worse, but I don't think he mind the drum and the drum. So after her, I'm gonna have you do one with Bishop. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'll put you on the spot. Amen. You should have never told me you were playing. All right, bro. Is it too high, Zayana? It's a little bit too high, huh? I don't know. I don't even know how to lower that. No, that one doesn't lower. So you wanna pass then? You do it next Sunday, or we get a.
Oh, you can hit it.
There you go. Did you touch?
Yeah.
There you go.
You got it.
All right, good one.
You got it.
Thank you.
Yeshua, deep down in my heart. I love Yeshua, deep down in my heart. I love Yeshua, deep down in my heart. I love Yeshua, deep down in my heart. And His love goes deep, deep down, down, deep down in my heart. It goes deep, deep down, down, deep down. Thank you.
And then we have a couple songs. She's gonna just she's gonna sing that. When I Christ you whip it. Okay, there it is.
Come on, baby.
My Jesus, my Savior. Let's us worship and then we can turn up to the end to the hand of preacher for today.
Switch.
You wanna show us what you got to? Amen. You play nice. I like that. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Amen. 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 You gotta put you up there more often.
Yes. Yeah. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So many willing.
Sister Nelly, come forward. Oh, you wanna be able to watch that? Can you get the mic to help Sister Nelly sing?
It's put on a church.
Yeah. So can we take that? It's on the projector.
Yep.
Amen.
All right, everyone. You could stand if you can stand. We're gonna praise the Lord. This song is called "Shout to the Lord."
Amen.
And yeah. All
right. Amen.
Amen.
All right, help me sing while worship church.
Hallelujah.
There you go.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love.
Yeah. bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Nothing compared. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
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 I got a feeling.
Yeah.
Everything is gonna be alright.
Hey.
To be able to speak for us today.
He's not only speaking here, but he's speaking over Bishop Church as well. You know, so I feel like sometimes we try to overwork him. Because last couple weeks ago, he spoke over Bishop, and I was there. I wasn't able to reach him. Maybe I was trying to reach him, and then my text was going somewhere else. I was trying to get him to come preach for us. But the other day, I went to Bishop. Sure enough, I went there. He blessed my soul with his message. It's an honor to have him this morning to be able to hear from him again. God bless you, Bishop. We honor him. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated. I'm just getting ready to take this stand. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
First of all, give honor to the Most High and our Redeemer, Yeshua. And I want to give honor to the pastor of this wonderful assembly, your dear Pastor Jonas, and his dear wife who serves with him.
Also,
to all of the ministry leaders that are part of the local assembly. And also, I want to give honor to my dear brother, Bishop Enoch, who is here as well, and to each and every one of you. We greet you in the mighty name of our Savior. And I count it a pleasure to be here again with you. My wife was not able to attend on today. She sends her regards.
Oh, okay.
And she would have been here, but she had to attend to some other things. But she sends her regards. And we're here, and we are in expectation to see what the Most High has for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
I received the text yesterday from your pastor, and you know, sometimes I don't have the good enough sense to say no, so I said sure, I'll be there.
Hallelujah, thank you.
Not a problem. And please don't feel that I'm overworked. I was raised in ministry where we were taught that you have to always be ready.
Amen. Amen.
And so I've lived by that for over three decades.
Hallelujah.
And so for us, we regard ourselves as servants of the Almighty.
Amen.
So whatever it is that we can do, and whatever it is that the Almighty has in store for His people, we always want to make sure that we're available.
That's right.
And we want to make sure that we hear from Him.
That's right.
There are many in the world today who think that the only message that a person gets is from the Bible. And we know that the Bible is the source of that message, but the message comes ultimately from the Spirit.
Amen.
Of the Almighty.
Amen.
It is the Spirit of the Almighty that has been breathed into the earth realm and has caused men to write.
Yes.
And so when we hear from the Almighty, it is more than just opening the pages of the written book and preaching from it. We have to hear the voice of the Almighty by His Spirit through the book and the instrumentality that the Almighty has to deliver that message.
Yes.
And so I'm always open to want to know what it is that the Father has for his people, because there are many different needs that individuals have. And I'm aware of the fact that the Almighty is concerned about the individual needs of people.
Yes.
He is concerned about the personal lives of people.
Amen.
And not just their future eternal destinies.
Right.
But he is concerned about people's in the right now.
Yes, amen.
And so I find it important that when we share the word of the Most High, that we be very sensitive to that.
Yes.
I don't always know what the Most High is going to have me to say. And I don't worry about it. I trust him.
Yes.
Before we get into the teaching today, I do want to make known that we have a product table in the back corner area with some different written literature that we have. And also, there are two booklets that I've written. One is called The Ancient Israelites, a Melanated People. If you might be interested in this, the research we've done in this, it's a short read, but we have this available for a $6 donation. Also, we have another booklet that we've written that's called Ha'am Elohim, or it's just in English, it's called The People of Elohim. It's a reading or writing that has to do primarily with showing how that people of the Most High are all tied to the house of Israel. And so for those who might be interested in those concepts that are rooted in scriptures, I definitely invite you to go and support our work and purchase one of those books with a donation of $6. Our other pamphlets and leaflets that we have, they're free for the taking. But we have brought our material to somewhat be able to expose you to other aspects of what we teach and what we provide to the body of Messiah. This is something that we do generally when we go and we minister in various places around the country and outside the state. And so these are just a couple that we have. There's another booklet that we have also, which is called History of Sabbath Keeping Throughout the Centuries, which is just simply a list of historical quotes of historians from the first century all the way to the present that provide revelation with regard to how the ancient church kept the Sabbath. That's a topic, of course, that most of the Western Christian church wants to evade.
Right.
But it's difficult to get away from the history and all of the information that bears witness to this truth. So that's available as well. That's a $10 donation we have for that particular one, because it's a large amount booklet. But we just want to make those products available to you, for those of you who are interested. Pastor Jones, thank you for inviting me.
Amen.
I want to say that first of all, and I was asking Abiyah, what is it that I need to share? And I began to consider, as the Most High has been having me teach in our Bible Institute, on the biblical calendar, there is a lesson we did in that course. We just finished up a mini course, and in that lesson, we were saying some things about what most would regard as the feast of Yah. And so I want to share on that today, and I'm going to share this teaching in a more concise way, because this kind of a teaching would probably take an hour and a half to exhaust, and I'm not here to give you a theological lecture today, but there are some things that the Most High has put in my spirit that the saints need to know. And so whenever he does that, I have to be obedient. Hallelujah. How many of you know that the Most High has called us to go unto perfection?
Amen.
Amen.
If you read in the book of Hebrews,
yes,
it teaches that we're to move away from the doctrine or teaching of repentance from dead works and faith toward Elohim, from baptisms, from the laying on of hands, and from teaching about eternal judgment. And the writer said, but these things we will do if we need to. But we must move on to perfection, or move on to completion. In other words, as a believer, there is much more that the Almighty wants us to know about than the simple message of salvation from sin. And I know most of us here that live in the United States of America, I'm sure that we could be able to reiterate what it takes to be saved. There is no shortage of preaching, teaching, hearing the scriptures preached and taught on the television, the radio devices. There is no shortage of the message about Yahshua, Jesus, being a savior.
Right.
In Paul's day, many did not know the name Yeshua.
Ils n'ont pas connu Paul,
right?
Ils n'ont pas connu le Christ.
Jesus. They didn't know.
Ils n'ont pas connu.
But in this time and age in which we live, the message has reached every continent. So, with that knowledge about him, it is important that we come to terms with the reality that the Father has an expectation. Now, I know most believers don't like that word, expectation. Expectation is like a bad word. Because, you know, we're supposed to be saved by grace, and grace is free, and salvation is free. But the reason why salvation is free is because you didn't pay for it.
That
doesn't mean that there is nothing that you have to do or I have to do in order to receive it. It just means you didn't pay for it. See, I can have a will, and I can have inheritance designated for different ones when I transition. And those who are the beneficiaries, they didn't work for that inheritance. The inheritance is there. They didn't work for it.
Et si le compte document pour dire comme si la salle qui était derrière cette petite ligne, monde qui va recevoir le travail pour ça.
They didn't do anything for it. But there are stipulations in a will that has to be met in order for them to receive that inheritance.
Document
that they didn't pay for.
Bénéficier là, pour bénéficier pour faire.
And so oftentimes as believers, there are things that we may fail to understand about the Creator, that yes, He loves us and He saves us and He sent the Messiah to come so that we might be saved, and He showed His love towards us while we were yet sinners, while we didn't even have a desire to want to know anything about Him. He did all of that.
Yes.
He put Himself out there. Without even knowing whether those who He was doing it for would receive and reciprocate positively.
Right.
So
he did all that. But that does not change the fact that the Almighty still has expectations for those who are now His.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And so I want us to bow our heads in a word of prayer, and then we're going to read the text and begin to share. Avinu Melkeinu, I bless you, I thank you, I praise you for your mercies, I praise you for your kindnesses, I praise you for your graciousness toward each and every one of us. I thank you for this opportunity to be in this great assembly. I ask, Father, that you would guide me by your Spirit, your Ruach, that you would fill me with your wisdom,
yes,
to be able to articulate your word, to be able to say what's needed to those that are in this assembly.
Hallelujah.
Abba Yah, I ask that you alone,
yes,
would move and work and receive the glory out of everything that is accomplished.
Thank you, Lord.
And we will give your great name praise after everything is done. Be glorified in the mighty name of Yeshua, Jesus, our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
For those of you who have your Bibles, I would like for you to open them to the book of Leviticus, the 23rd chapter. And I'm going to read verses 1 through 4.
And I've got
bless the mighty one of Israel. Leviticus chapter 23.
Leviticus 23.
Verses 1 through
4.
Bless His great name.
Bless His great name.
And Yahuwah spoke to Moses, or Moshe, saying, speak to the children of Israel, and you shall say to them, the feast or the Moedim of Yahuwah, which you shall call holy convocations or sacred assemblies, these are my feasts,
Hallelujah.
Or Moedim. 6 days shall thou do work, but on the seventh day is the Sabbath, a rest, a holy convocation to Yahuwah. Thou shalt not do any work, it is a Sabbath to Yahuwah in all your dwellings. These are the feasts or Moedim to Yahuwah, holy convocations which you shall call in their seasons. You may have your seats.
Hallelujah.
These three verses of this 23rd chapter, they provide the introduction to what is regarded as the Moedim, the appointed times of the Almighty.
Hallelujah.
Now, I did not read the majority of the 23rd chapter. And that was purposeful because I wanted to make sure that I be mindful of the time, because there are many scriptures in the 23rd chapter that outline all of these Moedim. And what I want to do, I want to summarize the Moedim, or the feast. And before I do that, I want to define what the word Moedim means. Not everyone knows what the word Moedim means. And you know, for me, when I'm teaching or when I'm preaching, I may use terminology that everyone might not be familiar with. Some may be familiar with. And so I want to explain what that word means. It's a Hebrew word, and it means the appointed time. In your Bibles, you'll probably see the word feast. And when you see the word feast, much of the time what comes to your mind, and my mind as well, is a time of great celebration. With food and drink.
Manger avec boisson.
And dance and expressions of joy, because the word feast in our mind means something that is of celebration. And while the appointed times of the Creator involve celebration, and he says that you are to perform celebration, yet the word means appointed time.
Je vais dire comme ça, mot fissant, il veut dire son lait spécial que bon Dieu t'a mis pour moi.
So the focus of the declaration that the Almighty gave to Moses.
Je pense à quel mot bon Dieu t'a mis pour Moïse.
To go and tell the children of Israel is that there are these specific appointed times that they need to be aware of, that are scheduled during certain seasons of the year. Appointed times. An appointed time is very similar to scheduling a date.
So let's dire comme ça que laisse abonger des médias comme
si with someone.
Be très significant pour dire c'est les bon Dieu de mettre même genre auto sur mon photo que vous parlez.
You know, when I met my wife,
is he not a man?
I scheduled an appointed time.
Is he not a man? Did he meet your temple or not?
For her and I,
for the memory,
to meet together.
We were going to be awesome.
An appointed time.
Non, laisse
a particular day.
Non, dit non, juste
and time.
Non, laisse.
And I'm sure some of you who have significant ones in your life, you probably have scheduled special times.
Même avec qui gagne mon dans la vie ou qui gagne ménage mari ou met des temps de côté.
Where you might say,
qui est capable dire,
on Saturday night at 8 p.m. you're to be with me at the Melting Pot restaurant.
On les dit comme ça.
Down in Tacoma.
Samedi, nous gagne pour nous aller à 8 h pour aller côté dans le restaurant.
I recommend you all go there.
What is it, salties? Bishop, you said salties?
I said the melting pot.
Oh, my call.
The melting pot.
Okay.
You know, an appointed time is a date.
Ok, il dit laisse à bon Dieu t'aider à part, c'était un jour pour nous pour avoir un bon temps avec bon Dieu.
It's a day of sharing a special occasion with the one that you are in love or covenant with.
So let's say consacré laisse ça, c'est un moment qui est très spécial pour que vous passer le temps avec monde qui est spécial pour vous.
So what the Almighty tells Moses is, he says, go tell the people. So go tell the people about my appointed times.
Bon Dieu dit Moïse, al di moun yo de lesa ke mete a pa pou nou.
And these special times are to be regarded as holy convocations, or in the Hebrew, as it is called, Kadosh Mikra. These are sacred assemblies. These are special times where you gather together with me.
So it's a lesser celeb pour mettre temps à part pour moi, pour passer temps à part et pour sacré pour moi.
And the Almighty said, and I want you to tell them that these are my appointed times. In other words, they originate with me.
Bon Dieu dit moi ça va. Il veut pour Dieu, tant ça c'est pour moi directement.
It's a part of my plan. It's a part of my purposes. It's something that has to do with what I have ordained relative to my plan for mankind.
So this was all say, the bagging will wear him, but say he's the meeting for real active cover.
Notice when you read that text.
Go ahead.
When you read that text, you notice in that second verse, he says, these are my appointed times. My feast. I remember many years ago when I was first learning about the way of the Most High from a Hebrew perspective, I would hear people refer to the appointed times as Jewish feasts. Anytime someone would talk about Passover, or they would talk about Pentecost, which is Shavuot, or any of the other celebrations, they would always refer to them as Jewish feasts, as if they originated with the Judean Israelite people. As I began to look at this scripture text and see that when the Almighty made covenant with the house of Israel, whom I call my ancient ancestors, as he was laying down the whole foundation for how they would live unto him, what the constitution for the nation would be, what the regulations would be for ordering the calendar, what they would celebrate as they were coming out of a pagan lifestyle and had been inculcated with nothing but paganism and the whole celebration of the pagan ways of life, the Most High was changing everything around and saying, okay, I want you to remember these appointed times throughout the year, the seasons that are related to me.
Bon Dieu dit comme ça, qu'il était fait pour le peuple à reconnaître tout ça, pour lequel il mettait la part pour lui-même.
Now I know I'm taking a little bit of time to emphasize that these appointed times are related to the Almighty, they originate with the Almighty, but it's important that I do that.
Il est très important pour m'enseigner non de temps ça bon Dieu demander pour te m'aider à parler.
Because the reason why it's important that I do that is because if in the minds of most believers you think, as I used to think, that these things that have been so called Jewish feasts, then what happens is that you begin to think that they are not related to you.
So ta pensé juste à pas ta supposé pour ou de passer pour Josué mais c'est non c'est pour lié.
And it's because we have been taught we're Christians and not Jews.
So y a toujours assez non non c'est chrétien non pas non pas non pas Jews.
Then these things that these Jews celebrate are not related to us.
Ça y est c'est pas parler pas parler à partir à nous même.
Because they're called Jewish feasts.
Parce que les Jews feasts.
But the text in this book that I'm reading says, from the Almighty, that these are my appointed times. So they did not originate with the quote-unquote Jews.
Because
for most of us, when we hear the term Jew, we don't see someone that's of a complexion. Not in our brains, because of what we've seen. Mm-hmm. Even though the historical reality is that the ancient Israelite people were people of color. That's a historical reality. Mm-hmm. Now, but because we have been trained as believers to think that that's their religion, this is our religion, that's their practices, these are our practices, we have nothing to do with that. What happens is that we fail to see what the Father has provided and made known for his people throughout all generations.
So nous toujours penser c'est pour juste arriver et pas pour nous mais pour nous connaître que bon Dieu te met tu vas pas pour nous.
I want to summarize what's noted in the 23rd chapter. You see, in the third verse, the first appointed time that the Most High gave was the... Go ahead, dear brother.
Go ahead, go ahead. Sure.
The first appointed time that the Almighty gave was the seventh day Sabbath.
The premier jour de Bala, c'était septième jour, Sabbath.
He gave the seventh day Sabbath as the first appointed time. This is how he begins when he starts talking about this 20 times. Because the Sabbath is a date day between Elohim and his people.
It's a date day. The Sabbath is a day that is not for the people, for the people.
And it's not just a day of rest, but it is also a day of gathering, because the Almighty said in the scripture text, it is a holy convocation or a sacred assembly time of gathering.
Ouais, pas seulement un jour pour nous chita, pour nous reposer, mais c'est un jour pour nous rencontrer ensemble, pour nous adorer.
So for those of us who meet on the Shabbat, the Sabbath, we do it not because it's a good idea or because it is the Sabbath, but we do it because there is a commandment within the text where the Most High says it is a holy convocation, a sacred time of gathering. That's what's in the text. That's the foundation of it. After that, we find that the Almighty gives out a list of appointed times that are annual, which means they're celebrated once a year.
Bon Dieu mette un calendrier chaque année pour te pour rencontrer une année par une fois par année.
The first one is called Pesach or Passover. The second one is called matzah or unleavened bread. How many of you heard of unleavened
bread?
The third one is called hapikarim or first fruits. The fourth one is called Shavuot, or commonly called by Pentecost. Most of us, when we hear the word Pentecost, our ears perk up. Oh, I know Pentecost.
Yeah.
Pentecost is Holy Ghost. Pentecost.
I know Pentecost.
Pentecost means 50, wow. And it is related to the Feast of Weeks. Shavuot means weeks in Hebrew, and it is related to that Hebrew feast.
Pentecost means 50 jours. Chaque 50 jours. C'est pas Pentecost que Jean nous le prend.
The fifth annual feast is called Yom Terah, and that is called the Day of Blowing Trumpets. And the sixth is called Yom Kippurim, or the Day of Covering. And finally, the seventh is called Sukkot.
Septième.
A Feast of Booths, commonly called Tabernacles. They
call it the Feast of the Booths, the Feast of Tabernacles.
And Now these appointed times, which the Almighty said when you celebrate them, you come together and you honor me and you offer certain sacrifices. In the chapter, it has all of these different guidelines on what particular animals are to be offered as a part of the worship and all of that. And of course, we don't offer any sacrifices now because there's no temple. And the Most High said, you know what? If you offer sacrifice somewhere else outside of the temple where the Most High's name is designated, you'll get in trouble for that. So there's no temple, there's no sacrificing going on. Not until the millennial kingdom comes. But what we notice about these feasts, these appointed times, is that they are times of great celebration, but also they provide a way that the Most High is teaching and declaring a message about the Messiah. Not only is the message of the Messiah declared in the feast, but also we find insight about the future restoration of everything. How many of you, from time to time, stop and think about when is everything going to wrap up? When is our Lord going to come? When is the time going to occur when we will spend eternity delivered from this life, delivered from all of the trials, troubles, struggles, difficulties, things that come upon our lives that make us uncomfortable, things that shake our world sometimes, things that turn it upside down. We hear the preachers preach that Yeshua, Jesus, is coming soon, but you know, they've been saying that he's been coming soon since the first century. I mean, you read over in the book of John and you read in the book of Revelation and you find that in those scriptures that it tells us that the Messiah is coming soon. So it's like, all right. We hear that he's coming soon, but when?
Right.
I remember back when I was a young believer back in the 80s, and I would listen to the prophecy preachers on TBN. How many of y'all remember TBN, Trinity Broadcasting Network? I used to watch Trinity Broadcasting Network every day, almost 24/7. Almost 24/7. And I remember them saying, well, you know, the Lord's going to come at the end of the century, 2000. And when 2000 came, I didn't see any clouds crack open. We still here. And so, in our minds and in our hearts, sometimes we begin to wonder, when is it all going to be over?
Right.
When is it all going to be said and done? Yes. And as I began to understand how the Most High speaks and how the Most High begins to reveal his ways to his people in scripture, I began to look at the Moedim, the feast, these appointed times. What is significant about them? Walk with me through this for just a moment. In Passover is the day that a lamb is slaughtered and the blood is put on the doorposts, and it signifies that those who are in the house that is covered by the blood are delivered or saved, rescued from death. That's what it signifies. Then there's also matzah, unleavened bread. What is that all about? Eating unleavened bread for 7 days. It typifies that our Messiah is righteous. It shows us a character about him. It shows us that he can be trusted. It shows us that he is sinless. It shows us that he's the one that was able to meet the requirements to die for the sins of the world. But what about the first fruits, Hapikareem? What is that all about? Hapikareem, or first fruits of the barley harvest, was celebrated on the day after the Sabbath, during the week of unleavened bread. Now, somebody might be saying, well, I don't know about all that. I don't know how that lines up. Let me just kind of simplify it a little bit. You know, we all just celebrated the resurrection of our Messiah not too long ago, right? And during the time right before Resurrection Day, is the celebration of Passover. Now, when you go into the scriptures and you read the Bible of what is commonly called the Lord's Supper, that was Passover.
Yes.
That our Lord was celebrating. And after Passover, 3 days after, you come to the day after the seventh day Sabbath. We read in the scriptures that our Lord rose from the dead.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
Something that we know. Something that's central to what we have been taught in our faith, right? But one of the things that most of us are unaware of is that when the Messiah rose from the dead on that day, that was the same day that there were these sheaves of barley that were given to the priests that were to be elevated to the Almighty. It was first fruits. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying that this first fruit celebration represented the resurrection of our Redeemer. So are you saying that with all of these feasts that there is a message of great significance about our Lord? Absolutely.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Passover points to the death of the Messiah.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Unleavened bread shows Messiah being our righteousness.
Amen.
First fruits points to the resurrection of our Messiah.
Uh-huh.
But what about the next feast, Shavuot, commonly called Pentecost? I don't think I need to even say a word about Pentecost. I saw some of the Holy Spirit and expression around us today. See, when we hear the term Pentecost, we think of Acts chapter 2. Right?
Yes.
Right? And they were what? All assembled in one place.
Yes. One accord, right?
Right? Yes. They were with one accord.
Amen.
Right?
Right.
And it says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come.
Uh-huh.
Let me talk it to you in Hebrew. When the day of Shavuot was fully come.
Uh-huh.
That's the feast day.
Yes.
After the 7 weeks and one day had come.
Uh-huh.
They were all with one accord in one place. They heard a sound from heaven that sounded like a rushing mighty wind, and it was filled all the house where they were sitting, and they were all filled with what? The Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, the Ruach, and spoke with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now we on this side of the covenant, we get excited when we hear about Pentecost, but we don't know much about the root of what Pentecost means. Pentecost is the 7 weeks of Shavuot.
Mm-hmm. Plus one day.
It's one of these appointed times. Mm-hmm. See, it wasn't by surprise that the Messiah died after he celebrated the Passover. Remember, these are the days of the Creator.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't a surprise that he rose during the time of what is called first fruits.
That's right.
Go read over in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, round about the 22nd verse. You hear the Apostle Paul when he is talking about the resurrection. Uh-huh. And he's trying to tell the people, listen, the resurrection haven't taken place yet. Uh-uh. He said, listen, don't get discouraged. Don't get afraid. Don't think that you all are left here and that you have no hope. He said, listen, the resurrection's going to come, but I need to share content with you. Right. He wanted them to understand, this is how you know that the resurrection hadn't taken place yet.
My God.
See, they knew something about the harvest celebration.
That's right.
They understood what it meant, that any time you were about to gather in the harvest, you couldn't go and reap anything until you first brought the first portion to the priest. Right. And once the priest got it, he lifted it up to the Most High. Uh-huh. He made an elevation offering to the Most High. And then after that, you can go and reap the harvest.
That's it. That's
you can go and gather everything in. And so Paul says, with respect to the resurrection, he said, I want y'all to understand. He said that the Messiah is the first fruits.
Uh-huh.
Paul plainly declared it to us.
Uh-huh.
That the Messiah is the first fruits of all them that sleep. So why are these feasts important? Why are they important? There are date days. There are timetables. If you want to know and be on track about what's happening in the world, when the Almighty is about to get ready to do things, you need to know the times and the seasons.
Amen.
There comes a time in a believer's life where you can't just remain as a babe. You got to grow up. Don't talk to me here.
Yeah,
you got to grow up.
Uh-huh. That's right.
I don't expect any of these little ones I see around here in the congregation to remain as children. And neither do you. Somewhere along the line, you're going to expect them to graduate from the ABCs and graduate from 1 plus 1 and 2 plus 2. You're going to want them at some point in time to be able to know what is 3 times 5 and what is the square root of 100. And you're going to want them to know a little bit about some trig. You're going to want them to graduate and learn something so that as they grow, they'll be proficient in the world that they live.
Come on now. Yes.
Expectation after a while. And some of us in the body, we want to remain paid. When the Most High is saying, look, I'm about to send Mashiach back and I'm trying to get you ready. But if you don't know the time and the season, if you don't know how I'm working and how I'm doing it and how I'm going to bring you in to this time frame of being able to see, hallelujah,
there's
another feast that's called the blowing of the trumpets.
Hallelujah.
Feast of trumpets.
Amen.
What's significant about trumpets? Trumpets is significant because when we read in our Bibles, what does it tell us that's going to happen before the Messiah appears? Yes. What does it say? It tells us that when he comes in the clouds, it says that the angels are going to blow their shofar.
Hallelujah.
They're going to blow their trumpets.
Uh-huh.
And the whole world is going to hear it.
Hallelujah.
But the whole world ain't going to be picking up.
Come on.
They're going to see, but they're not going to experience. Trumpets, the feast of trumpets. It's teaching us about the things that are going to come. What about Yom Kippur? Day of Atonement. Day of Atonement is the day when the high priest performs atonement for the whole house of Israel. That was a very significant day. How does that relate to the Messiah? There's something very, very powerful about that. How does that relate to the Messiah? you read in the Bible, you know when Messiah rose, he saw Mary.
Yes.
She ran up on him. But when she ran up on him, he said, "Touch me not.
Right.
For I am not yet ascended
right.
to the Father." Now this is strange. This is real strange. Because later on in that day, he shows up to the disciples where they were hiding out at. He just pops through the wall. And they see him. You know, Mary had just gotten back there and told them, you know, our Lord, he's risen, he's risen. And they're like, what? Nah, he ain't risen. Thomas, he said, look, I'm not going to believe it unless I'm able to touch him.
Right.
Unless I'm able to put my hand through his hand and through his eyes, I ain't believing none of this.
Right.
And poof, Messiah come to them all.
Amen. Yes,
and he says to Thomas, here you go.
Amen.
Now what's interesting is that a while ago, Mary wasn't able to touch him.
Come on. Right.
But now, they're all able to touch him. All
right.
What was the difference? What was the difference? See, most of us, we hear about the death and the burial, the resurrection of the Messiah, know very little about what atonement is. See, when the Most High works, he has a process that he has to have done in working.
Uh-huh.
See, all the Messiah did when he died was become the slain lamb.
That's right.
He became the goat that was slaughtered by the high priest.
Uh-huh.
But after the high priest slaughters the goat, he takes the goat's blood and he goes into the temple behind the curtain where you have the Ark of the Covenant, which represents the throne of Elohim.
That's right.
He takes the blood of the goat and sprinkles it. He throws it on the mercy seat seven times.
Uh-huh.
With that blood, seven times.
Yep.
As a way of saying the atonement is complete for all of the sins.
That's right.
And you see, Messiah, after he died and spilled all of that blood, his spirit went down into the lower parts of the earth first. And then he got up from the grave.
Uh-huh.
And then he went up into the heavens.
That's right.
They said, how do you know he went up into the heavens? He told Mary.
That's right. He sure did.
Amen.
Help yourself.
He said to Mary, don't touch me. I haven't yet ascended. Why? Because there was a work of atonement he had to complete before he could come back and deal with everybody else.
Oh, go on now.
See, many of us in the body, we don't take time to think about the precision of the Creator. We just, I'm saved.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah, I'm saved. Mm-hmm. Your Elohim is very precise, baby. We need to understand the precision of the Creator.
Mm-hmm.
See, when I preach, I cannot preach a simple message. I have to teach science so that you understand a little more about your Savior. He is not so simple as you think he is. He wants you to know his precision, to know everything that he had to do in order to accomplish redemption for you. He became the high priest. Every one of them details you read about in the Torah, the Messiah had to fulfill.
He did
not just die on that cross. He went into the very throne of the Most High,
temple
of the Almighty in the heavens, where you see a menorah, that's the seven-branch candlestick. You see an altar of incense. You see a table of showbread with 12 loaves. This is all in the heavens.
Uh-huh, that's
newsflash, Zion, listen. When you read about the temple in the Bible, that is a prototype of heaven.
That's right.
Messiah went in there, and he brought his blood before the throne of the Creator. Before the throne, sprinkle the blood seven times, letting the Father know it's done. Atonement is done. But it ain't just done for the covenant people. It's done for every sin of every human being on the planet. That way now,
touch me.
That's right.
Touch
that's
me.
Right. That's right.
Oh, he said, touch me.
Right.
That's Yom Kippur.
That's one. Yep.
That's Yom Kippur. What about the last feast? Tabernacles. Tabernacles represents the millennial kingdom age. Some might say, well, I thought we were just going to heaven after heaven. Well, our destiny Zion, when Messiah comes. How many of y'all looking for the Messiah to come?
Amen.
When he comes, we're not going to heaven when he comes.
That's right.
You say you a lying prophet. No. Read your Bibles.
Right.
When he comes, he's going to establish his kingdom and his throne on the earth.
Yes.
Zechariah chapter 14. Write it down. Write it down. You can read about it. Zechariah chapter 14. Also read Revelation chapter 20. It talks about it. He's going to set up his kingdom and his throne here on the earth.
Amen.
Sukkot represents the time period when we are ruling and reigning with the Messiah. And we are remembering how he was with us while we were in our wilderness experience in the world. Because Zion, listen, right now we're in a wilderness experience. We're dealing with all the stuff in this world. We're dealing with the stuff in the wilderness, the animals, the snakes. We're dealing with all of the stuff and all of the trials and all of the troubles. That's why the Bible says we're just pilgrims passing through this world. This world is not our home. We're on our way to Israel. Messiah comes and sets up his kingdom. So don't get comfortable here. I know many of us are comfortable. We're trying to make a living here. And most of the time, we get so caught up in our trying to make life comfortable that we forget that the Lord is saying, listen, I want you to be about my business. Listen, I want you to win somebody to me. Listen, I want you to teach my word. Listen, I want you to live right. Listen, I want you to be an example to those around you, because there are those who know not. They know not of my ways. I want you to be an example, because this world is not our home. These feasts are so significant in teaching us about all of what the Most High has in store for us.
Hallelujah.
As we begin to understand what they're about.
That's right.
Walk them out. The Most High begins to show us what's next on the horizon. Next thing on the horizon is trumpets. We look for the trumpet. We look for the trumpet to blow. Zion, the Lord wants to do some mighty things in our lives. And as we grow in him, as we learn of him, as we begin to discover more about what it is he wants, it is so important that we begin to say yes. Yes to your ways. Yes. I want to encourage each of you to begin to look into the great significance of these appointed times of the Creator.
Amen.
To some, this is new information, but it is something that the Most High wants you to grab hold of. Because as we grab hold of it, as we learn of it, there's great things that the Lord does in and through our lives.
Hallelujah.
Because it is attached to him.
Hallelujah.
I close on that note.
Hallelujah.
Let us stand.
Hallelujah.
I put you back into the hands of your pastor.
Amen. Hallelujah. What a marvelous message. Amen. 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 Thank you, God, for this marvelous word. Amen. Amen. I thank Bishop for these great words. Amen. Thank God for all of you that's here. And the sisters have to leave. The baby was sick. You know, they have so they had to go. But we thank God for them. I pray for them before they leave.
Yes.
Let's just, you know, have Bishop just close us up, you know, and
before I do that, you know, I wanna, you know, make sure that I, you know, wanna acknowledge all of you or minister that I didn't acknowledge earlier. I thank God for him and the family that show up today. God bless you and everybody, your sister, grandma, God bless you and all the brothers. God bless you, and I thank God for Bishop for this marvelous work.
Yes, amen.
Amen. We thank God for that magnificent word from the Royal Confidence of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Yes.
And I got to do what the Spirit tells me to do,
yes,
too. He has literature back there on the table, and anyone who wants any of that literature, I'll pay for it.
Oh, thank you, Lord.
And if there's somebody in there who wants some, so whatever you want,
yeah,
you
get it.
Amen.
And
thank you, Lord.
Just let you know what it is, I'll pay for it. Amen. Amen. Because that is, there's some stuff that you know, the Bible says study to show yourself approved, right?
Yes.
You do what?
Amen.
Dividing the word of truth.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And so we thank God that he brought some of that, amen.
Yes.
And it's all supporting his the ministry. And y'all might not know, but you know it takes money to pay lights and pay gas and do different things. So I just thank God for I truly got a blessing out of the word. And what's kind of funny is yesterday at our Shabbat Sabbath service, that's what we were teaching on.
Amen.
Yeah. But he went even further.
Amen.
Amen. So I thank God for that. Amen.
Amen.
That Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen.
Father God, as you assign the Holy Ghost to help them get ready to be understand this special day that you put aside for them, Father God, to know what they mean to us. God, we ask you to bless Bishop as he pulled the words unto us, Father God. We ask you, Father God, those ones that from the sound of his voice that receive these words, let these words begin to marinate in the spirit. Oh, Father God, as they're living here, Father God, never from your presence, let them continue to keep this word inside of them, Father God. So therefore, you said, Father God, the word that we hide inside of us, do not let this word never depart from our mouth. God, we ask you, Father God, let us be a blessing. Let us be a light in this world, Father God. When people show us, Father God, they can see Jesus to us. Oh, Father God, we thank you for this ministry. We thank you, Father God, for these visitors. We thank you for those ones that's in the hospital bed that you're getting ready to release. God, we thank you for this children that you have given us. We thank you for the wife. We thank you for the family. We thank you for the members. We thank you for those ones that are in the hospital bed that getting ready to be released today. God, Father God, we continue to ask you to continue to pour your blessing upon us. Father God, we ask you to continue to watch over this wall. Oh God, prepare us, Father God, for when Jesus come back. Father God, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's God people say amen.
Amen.
Let's God people say amen.
Amen.
May the light of God shine upon you. May the light of God guide you. May the light of God protect you as you leave it from this place, never from his presence. Let the word of God stay inside of you until Jesus return. Now you are dismissed. Hug one somebody.
Hallelujah.
And if anyone needs any milk, there's milk.
Yeah.
Back table, and if you know people who